My name is Alessandra Savini. I'm from Italy, University of Milano Bicocca, and I'm associate professor. I teach summer in geomorphology to master students, and I'm here to present the link between summer in geomorphology and extreme environment, just to give an introduction to the topic. So, summer in geomorphology is the study of landforms and processes in the submarine domain with a focus on their evolution through time and space. On land, we can have a perception of landforms and landscape by our sight, but in the underwater environment, there's this vast mass of water that make the underwater world hidden from our sight, and so we have to use proper technology to have a model at the end of what there is under the seafloor. And the seafloor actually include a multitude of different features. So one main thing that is an immense desert without anything, but the reality is very far from here. The first information we collected regarding the variability of the landscape in the submarine domain were collected using single beam echosounder. And this is a map, the first map that have been produced showing the global ocean seafloor. And is amazing, to my opinion, thinking that has been provided also with the support of a painter, because they used not only the bathymetric information, so the depth measurement to provide this map, but they also use the effect, the shaded relief effect provided by the support of a painter that give us the 3D perception. The 3D perception is what change our understanding when we look at a map, at the seafloor map. Today, to have this global view of the ocean, we use a satellite, and especially satellite altimetry that measuring the gravity field is able to provide this global view with a good detail, but still not enough to see very well all the variability of landforms that characterize the submarine domain. What I mean with detail is basically resolution. For example, if you look at a part of this global view of the ocean seafloor, the Arctic Ocean, and you zoom in and you try to reach a detail in the area that you zoom in, you see that at a certain moment you lose actually the perception of the variability of the seafloor. But now we are able actually to get a higher definition, higher resolution, not using satellite, but using multi-beam echosounder today. Multi-beam echosounder are able to give a detail such as this one, in which you can see other landforms appear, such as sedimentary waves, depressions, and if you look at a certain region, you can even see that there are some depressed features on the seafloor. Look at them in detail, we can zoom in, and we start to lose again the detail on this map. But another important advancement that technology gave us to reach a higher resolution is the possibility to use this multi-beam echosounder on ROV, on underwater vehicles, remotely operated vehicles or underwater autonomous vehicles. In this way, the multi-beam can get closer to the seafloor and can get a resolution that is even sub-meter resolution. And so, if you look at this feature, this depression that is more or less 10 meters deep and 300 meters in diameter, and you perform a survey using an IRV equipped with a multi-beam echosounder, you can see that the detail can increase a lot and we can reach a sub-metric resolution. So, what's the take-home message of all this discussion? We have now map of the seafloor maps. The seafloor map are actually model of what there is under the water. And this model is provided by a variety of technology from satellite, ship-based, multi-beam survey, and ROV or autonomous underwater vehicle-based multi-beam survey. The resolution of the map is basically the dimension of the single cell, the single element that is composing this map. And is defined by, obviously, an x, and y, that define the coordinates, and the zeta. The zeta is the depth. And the dimension of this single cell is the final resolution that you can get. We can obtain map from kilometric resolution to submetric resolution using this range of technologies, from satellite to ship-based survey to underwater vehicle survey. And in this example, it's amazing how you can see the detailed map of this pockmark, in which we can see other additional depression and Amoky topography. And if you consider that the ROV can also use videos and cameras, you can also obtain a direct observation of this variability you have. In the submarine environment, there are specific, we say, geomorphic processes that can work at different spatial and temporal scale. And some of them are those ones that characterize what we call the extreme environments. The submarine landforms that characterize extreme environment in the deep sea actually include a variety of landforms. And some of them are more known than others, for example, the hydrothermal vents, and some other less known, think for example to the brine pools. So these are underwater basin separated from the water mass where salt or other chemical compounds can be melted by seawater and create brine pools totally separated from the water mass. And here specific process, specific organism can survive in this extreme environment. But some of the most, maybe I would say, widespread, even if extreme, environment, and especially in the Arctic Sea, are definitely the coal seeps. Coal seeps are area where hydrocarbon gases, mainly composed by methane, seeps out of the seabed after migrating into the subseafloor, generally along fractures or faults, and then they reach the seafloor, and as soon as they reach the seafloor, they create specific morphological features, specific landforms. And these landforms can be very different from one to each other. There are also some specific geochemical processes that interact with the rising fluids and interact differently from one area and the other areas. And that's why we can have really different, not only landforms, but even habitat, for example, that can thrive in different conditions. Among the different landforms, we have mud volcanoes. Mud volcanoes are formed by the eruption of mud, gases, and water at the seabed. They can create features that can vary a lot in size and shape. They can be high, hundreds of meters, they can have diameter of hundreds of meters, even kilometers, or they can be very small, with diameter of few meters, 1 meter high. That depends on the kind of processes that is controlling everything, and the time scale maybe in which this process acts on the seafloor. In addition to mud volcanoes that are positive features, we also have negative features, crater-like features, that we call pockmarks, such as the one that we saw before. Pockmarks are indeed defined as crater-like features, so they correspond to depressed features, and inside them you can find different fabric of sediment, depending on still on the history and the process that create this depression. One common sedimentary feature that we can find in pockmarks are carbonate crust, and especially methane-derived carbonate crust. And regarding the methane-derived autogenic carbonates, so these are carbonate rocks, and the point is that they can occur at the seafloors as nodules, carbonate slab, or very huge pavement of the seafloor. And an additional tool we have to study in detail these data, and in particular to obtain quantitative information from this data, is the use of advanced image analysis techniques, such as, for example, the OBIA, the object-based image analysis, using specific algorithm, and in some cases also developing your own algorithm with that are applied to all these multi-source and multi-scale data set that you can obtain from the seafloor. You can actually derive very important quantitative information regarding the distribution of the habitat that are characterizing extreme environment. And if you imagine to couple all this information with data collected by colleagues such as sedimentologists, geochemists, biologists, ecologists, you have at the end the final picture that can explain why we have all this variability, why we have all these spatial patterns that are defined at this scale, the extreme environment, and which are maybe the threats that are impacting this environment at our times.